the top of a hill, be nailed to a cross, and left for dead. We stood with the passerbys and those in the crowd. We saw a sword pierced through his side, taken down off of that crossbeam, and placed in a cheap excuse for a tomb, one that was borrowed one of us. And today, Father God, this morning when we wake from our slumber, we stand in the garden with the women and the disciples and possibly a gardener who may have been there and look in the tomb and our hearts stop in amazement. We cannot believe what we're looking at. Grave clothes left on the cold, damp, dusty ground. An empty tomb with guards, a ginormous stone that had been rolled away. And we stand there and we know, Father God, beyond the shadow of a doubt, this isn't the work of grave robbers. It's not the work of the Pharisees or the other religious elite. It's not some magic trick. It is the power of the willful purpose of the Creator of the heavens and the earth, our God, who made a promise that one day He would defeat death once and for all. And this morning, Father God, all the voices in this room exclaim, Amen, Amen. Father God, it is a pleasure to come together now to bring praise and glory through the pictures on the screen, through the words of the hymns, the sounds of the instruments, and the lyrics of the praise songs. Those are but a mere pittance that we can offer to you for all that you have given us. And so we come today, Lord, to celebrate the fact that your Son, our Savior, is victorious. He walked out of the grave. He now shines in a new light so that we may be deemed righteous in your eyes. Thank you. As we come to the communion table later today, Father God, I pray that you would put on our hearts to allow your Son and your Spirit to permeate our lives as we stand in a moment of intimacy between you and our faith. And it might seem ironic, Father God, that we would celebrate communion in remembrance of the death of Christ on the day we're supposed to celebrate his resurrection. But we're reminded that without death, we may not live anew. Your word tells us that we are all being transformed day by day into his image, from glory unto glory. In the name of the Christ who dwells amongst us today, I pray these things in all God's people. Amen.
Ephesians 2:10 says we are God's workmanship. In essence, His masterpiece. I don't know about any of you, but when I wake up in the morning and I look in a mirror, I do not see a masterpiece. Well, maybe a Picasso, But I want to be His masterpiece. I want to be everything that God's created me to be. And so I go to Him in prayer and I say, Dear Heavenly Father, do whatever it takes in my life to mold me into the image of Your Son. Make me into Your masterpiece. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Nice.
Whoa, who are you?
I'm God.
You're not God.
Yeah, I am. You said a prayer. Here I am. That's how it works.
Okay, if you're God, then make it snow in here.
You know, I really don't want to make it snow in here because it gets kind of yucky.
Yeah, see, you're not God. God would not use the word yucky.
Yeah, but it's a Greek word.
Oh. Okay. If you're God, then what does Lamentations 15:9 say?
Lamentations is a very short book. It only has 5 chapters.
Oh, why is it so short?
I was tired of lamenting.
Oh, okay. Oh, if you're God, then who's going to win the World Series this year?
You know, I'm not even playing games. Why are you so much into playing games?
You are God.
Well, David, what?
You answered my question with a question.
I did? I did, didn't I? Oh, there you go, dude. Okay, step right up.
Okay. Wait, what's the hammer and chisel for?
That's what I'm going to use to form you into my original masterpiece.
Oh. Well, hang on. I thought you were a carpenter.
That was my son.
Oh, that's right. Okay. God, how do you know what to chisel and what to leave?
Well, I'm going to take everything in your life that's not needed. Kind of like dead weight.
Ooh, speaking of dead weight, if you could chisel all around in here, that would be fantastic. I mean, it showed up a couple of years ago, and I've tried diet, I tried exercise, my wife had me trying Pilates. That was awkward. Oh, and then if you could chisel a line right here, and then like 2, 3, like 8 lines right there, that'd be awesome.
You're funny.
Well, you made me that way.
I also made the platypus.
The platypus?
What I'm trying to say is, most of my children like to talk instead of do the work. You want to talk, or can I chisel? Talk, chisel, talk, chisel.
No, chisel.
Okay, well, most of my children like to talk.
Oh, not me. Bring on the chisel.
Through my Holy Spirit, I'm going to bring up things in your life that I want you to work on.
Okay.
Like anger. I created the emotion, but you use it the wrong way. You compare yourself to others instead of me. You try to people please. You're lazy, but you try to pretend you're so busy. You have a problem with lust.
Okay, time out. I do not have a problem with lust.
You don't have a problem with lust?
No, I can do it anytime I want. Okay. It's just maybe we should take a little break. You know, I think I'm doing pretty good here.
Okay, we're doing good work here, but what do you see when you look in the mirror?
Well, I see me.
Well, that's just it. You and everybody else need to see my son.
Yeah, see, don't take this the wrong way, God. But when I start looking more like your son, Jesus, people start getting uncomfortable around me. I mean, even my church friends are all like, oh, why are you doing that? You're holier than thou. And I don't think we're supposed to make people feel uncomfortable, right?
So what you're trying to say is you'd rather play God over certain areas of your life than for me to be God over your whole life.
That is not what I said.
That's what you meant.
Yes, it is. Okay. It's just hard to talk to you. I mean, you know everything that I'm thinking. All I'm saying is that maybe we take a little break, you know, a little sabbatical. I'll stay right here.
That's just it. You never stay right there. You're either moving toward me or away from me. You know what that thing is called? That's called control. You want to control or can I chisel? Control, chisel, control, chisel.
No, chisel.
Okay.
But can we chisel where I want to chisel?
That is called control.
Okay.
This right here, the secret sin you're holding on to, that you keep running to when you're hurting, angry, lonely, tired, it's making you a whitewashed tomb. You ready for me to chisel this out of your life?
Yeah.
See, it's a process. It's not a sprint. It's a marathon. It's your whole life. The only thing you're going to look forward to in the end of your life when you hear me say, well done, my good and faithful servant. That's the prize. Heaven.
Okay, but it hurts.
Pardon me, this hurts me more than it hurts you.
Yeah, right. Okay! I don't think you understand this pain.
Pardon me?
Okay, you're asking me to sacrifice a lot, God.
Don't talk to me about sacrifice. I sent my son to die on the cross for sin and for pain. But I also did it for another reason. I did it to give you freedom. Do you know what insanity is? Insanity is doing the same thing over and over and over again, but expecting different results. And you've been going to this for years. Allow me to produce character where you so much worry about your image.
But I was just thinking that
your thoughts are not my thoughts.
What if we went another way?
Your ways are not my ways.
Oh, I can't, okay?
You can.
I can't be good.
That's your excuse. You can't be good.
It's not an excuse. I can't.
Oh, my son, in the beginning, I said it was good. I made you good. Be good.
Yeah, but you and I...
What?
Nothing. You wouldn't understand.
Me, God of all universe, wouldn't understand what one of my children is trying to tell me. Try me.
It's just... I've let you down so many times, God.
In this relationship, I was never holding, you were never holding me out. I hold you up with my victorious, righteous right hand. Remember, I hold you up.
Okay. Chisel away. But just be prepared for what you're going to find in there, because I know who's inside. Because I get up every morning, and I look in the mirror, and I hate who I see. I see this little kid who gets up and he dresses like an adult, and I go out and I try to do what I'm supposed to do, but I can't. I can't be who everyone expects me to be. I can't be who I want to be, let alone who you created me to be. So inside is this scared, stupid little kid that you chisel away. You just be prepared.
You have listened to voices for far too long that were not me. You think you're junk, don't you? After doing the dance to get the hug, put your head down and throw at night, you think you're junk. Listen, I don't take time to make junk. How can I show you how much my love is from the east to the west? Or my love has no end? I know. Reach your back pocket.
What?
Reach in your back pocket.
Why?
You arguing with me? Reach in your back pocket.
God.
Yes.
I just mean, God, I'll do that right now.
You were using my name in vain.
You know, it's just a name. It's just a saying.
It's a name above all names. It's more than a saying. Let me teach you something about my name. Reach your back pocket.
Oh, my God.
You know what that is?
This is a page from my journal I wrote in college. How did you get this?
Hello.
Oh, right.
Go ahead and read it.
I love Andrea Lauder.
The other side?
Oh, sorry. I married her.
I was there.
Oh, right. Oh. Dear God, did I hear you right today? Did I hear you say you love me? Even though you and I both know that I've messed up so many times. Did I hear you say that you want to use me? I feel so useless. If you'll take me and use me, God, I give you all that I am. Take me. I love you, God.
And I love you too much to leave you where you're at. So this salvation that you're holding on to, don't let it be some sentimental gush or some head knowledge. There will be problems, but don't look at it as a prison. Look at it as a father disciplines his son. A father disciplines the one he loves.
But it's going to be tough.
It will be tough. But when you want it to lie and you turn everything over to me, thinking it would be easy, there will be problems. There will be chaos. But be a good cheer. I have conquered the world. You know what I want you to do? I want you to look out there and just say, Jim is God's original master.
Jim is God's.
No, not the way you see yourself or you're afraid that everybody else sees you, but the way I made you, the way I created you, the way I see you.
Jim is God's original masterpiece.
Yes, you are.
And so are you. God doesn't make junk. You are all an original masterpiece.
I don't know about you, but when it comes to sculptures and sculptors, I know nothing. Never took art history in school of any kind. The last time I did anything with sculpting was in elementary school when I made an ashtray for my parents who don't smoke. So this week I Googled about sculptors and sculpting, and I found that someone has given a top five list of the best sculptors in history. And I realized that some of those names I actually knew. Names like Donatello and Michelangelo. They really weren't Ninja Turtles. A man named Rodin. Know him? Think about it. And then there were a couple that I don't know at all. Bernini and Brancusi. Anybody heard of them? A couple of you smart heads have. And then I saw that there are steps that people have written out to help you become a sculptor. Steps that sculptors utilize, they go through to create their masterpiece. And literally the first step in the process is that the sculptor has a vision of what he wants, that block of stone, granite, marble, whatever it is, a vision of what he wants it to look like, what he wants the end product to be. And then what he does is he takes a saw, if it's a lot of stuff he's got to get rid of, or a chisel and hammer if it's a little bit, and he cuts away all the excess. And he gets that big block of stone down to just what he needs in order to create his masterpiece. All the unnecessary stuff, all the not needed stuff, all the stuff that's just going to get in the way, he gets rid of. And he works with what he needs to create his vision. And I realized that in that, there are similarities that come from the resurrection for us. For the resurrection of Jesus, I hope we'll see today and learn today, is real, and that it happened, and that because it happened, we can have life. And not just any life, but we can have the life that God had a vision for us to have. That we can have the life that He desires us and longs for us to have. Real life. True life. Not this life that we all struggle so much playing around with. Turn with me, if you would, to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And we're going to read verses 12 through 28. Verse 12, but if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? If there's no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God. For we have testified about God that He raised Christ from the dead, but did not raise Him if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are to be pitied more than all men. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since God came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. But each in his own turn, Christ the firstfruits. Then when he comes, those who belong to him. Then the end will come when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father, after he has destroyed all dominion, authority, and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death, for he has put everything under his feet. Now when it says that everything has been put under him, it is clear that this does not include God himself, who put everything under Christ. When he has done this, then the Son himself will be made subject to him who put everything under him, so that God may be all in all. Many people in our world, some whom you perhaps know, have doubts about the resurrection. They read the story, they celebrate an Easter holiday, but they doubt, don't believe that Jesus actually was raised from the dead. In fact, if you were to talk to a lot of people and you ask them about just resurrection in general, and you would probably find that the concept of someone being alive, then dying, and then seeing them alive again is something they can't get their minds around. Something they can't grasp or think is real. That was what was going on with the people at the Church of Corinth. They had this thought that the resurrection of anybody, let alone of Christ, was not real. It did not happen. It didn't take place. And so Paul is writing this letter to them, or this part of the letter, specifically addressing this idea of the resurrection. And he says to them, if there's no resurrection, then there are several things that are going to take place or that will happen as a result of that you don't want to take place. And the first thing that he says is, if there's no resurrection at all, then Christ himself has not been raised from the dead. Now, think about that. That is an enormous thing for him to say. That carries a lot of impact, a lot of weight behind it. If there's no resurrection, Christ has not been raised either. Therefore, our faith means nothing, because there's nothing to have faith in. Paul uses the word futile. It's useless. It's meaningless. You might as well throw it away, because it's worthless. Death has not been defeated, and our sin has not been accounted for. Secondly, he says that if there's no resurrection, then to preach Christ is senseless. You see, if he's not raised from the dead, if Christ does not walk out of that tomb, if the tomb is not empty, then he ceases to be Christ. He is not the Savior. He is not the Messiah. He's accomplished nothing. All he did was simply die like all of us will. So to preach about him, to teach about him, makes no sense. Paul says, if he didn't walk out of the tomb, it is senseless to preach about him, because he becomes just another in the long line of wannabe messiahs throughout history who claim to be the Savior only to fall and to fail and to not bring about salvation. The third thing that Paul says, if there's no resurrection, then Paul says, I am a liar. Paul built his entire ministry, actually his entire life, upon the gospel message that said Christ died on the cross and walked out of the tomb on the third day. He preached it everywhere he went. He taught it to young men like Timothy and Titus and encouraged them to pass it on to their congregations and to the people they came in contact with. He went on missionary journey after missionary journey, going to these little towns, these villages of people, these cities, and planting churches. And the foundation of those churches was Christ is the Messiah. The tomb was empty. And he says, if that's not true, if that didn't happen, then I am a liar. And anyone who comes and tells you that, they are lying also. The fourth thing that he says, that if there's no resurrection, then we are all condemned. He's writing to the church at Corinth, right? To the supposed believers at Corinth. To those who have professed a faith in Christ, thinking that they now have hope and life, that they now have forgiveness of their sin, that they now have a right relationship with their Heavenly Father. And he says, if there's no resurrection, then Christ wasn't raised from the dead, and you are still condemned. You still live in your sin. Your debt has not been paid. Death has not been defeated. You still wallow in your ugliness and in your sin. You are not redeemed. And finally, he says, that if there's no resurrection, that if Christ did not walk out of the tomb, he said, then we who call ourselves believers, we're to be the most pitied people on the face of the earth. How many of you, when you share a trouble or a concern in your life, you love for people to pity you? Nobody likes to be pitied, right? In fact, we often say, no, I don't want your pity. Don't pity me. And what are we saying? Don't feel sorry for me. Right? Don't tilt your head to the side and nod and say, I'm so sorry. Right? We don't want that. Now, think about being pitied for something like following Christ. Because what does Christ teach? What did he teach? He said, if you want to follow me, pick up your cross and follow me. Okay, now let's think about this. He said, if you want to be my follower, take that cross that killed me. It's an instrument of execution. Pick that up, and then you can follow me. He said to the man who wanted to follow him, he said, Jesus, I want to be your follower, but I've got to go to my dad's funeral. And Jesus said, no, come now. He said to the one who wanted to follow him, okay, follow me, but you got to leave your family. Those are hard things. Those aren't fun things. We don't wake up every morning and say, oh man, I can't wait to put that cross on again today. Now, we might wake up sometimes and say, oh man, glad I get to leave my family today. Damn, that was supposed to be funny. Yes. Maybe I hit a little too close to home for some of you. He stated that those who would follow him needed to make him Lord of their life. Meaning, I take priority. No matter what else you got going on, no matter whatever other relationships you have in your life, I am number one if you're going to follow me. You see, if we do all of that, those are some pretty hard things to do, right? And then find out that it's a lie? Find out that Jesus didn't do what he said he was going to do, or didn't say what he said he was going to say? Then Paul says, then we're deserving of pity because we have allowed ourselves to give up all of this stuff, to go through persecution, to go through trials, to do all of these things for a lie. And he said, we're going to be pitied. People are going to look at us, and they're going to tilt their head, and they're going to nod, and they're going to say, oh, I'm so sorry. Paul teaches the Corinthians that the resurrection actually happened by sharing with them all of these negative things that would be happening if there was no resurrection. But the fact of the matter is, the tomb was empty. Christ arose. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, I'm beginning to think we're thinking it's still Friday in here. Many throughout history have tried to come up with alternate theories as to why the tomb was empty. Some have developed something called the swoon theory. The swoon theory says Jesus didn't really die. He just passed out from the pain he was in, or when he said, "I was thirsty," and they gave him the sponge, that there was some sort of sedative on it that caused him to pass out. And so they thought he was dead, and they placed him in the tomb, and the coolness of the tomb revived him, and he walked out. Some say that the only reason the tomb was empty is because the guards or the Romans or the Jewish leaders came and stole the body. Now, that's ridiculous because they're the ones who took pride in killing. They're the ones who wanted him dead. Why would they pretend that he rose from the dead? Then there are those who believe that the disciples stole the body. This is even more outrageous because of the 11 remaining disciples, 10 of them died for their faith in his resurrection. I don't know about you, but if I had helped steal the body and they said, "If you don't recant your faith, I'm going to put you on that cross," and I knew where the body was, yeah, I'm going to get the body. But they didn't, because the body wasn't there. There was also the theory that Mary Magdalene and the women, they went to the wrong tomb. And so when they went there to look for Christ and they said, where's Jesus? The person that was there said, "Oh, he's not here," because they were at the wrong tomb. See, it takes a whole lot more faith to believe those than it does to believe that the God of heaven and earth could actually be in control of life and death. But the fact is, the tomb was empty. And we have several proofs of that. The first comes from earlier in 1 Corinthians 15. If you read verses 3 through 8, what you're reading there is an early church creed. It is a Christian creed that the church used in their services as close as 5 to 6 years after Christ's death and resurrection. All right, so we're talking about a very, very short amount of time from the events to when the creed became part of their liturgy and part of what they believed and spoke. And in that creed, it says Jesus rose on the third day and that he appeared to over 500 people. Now, the significance of that and the significance of it being so close to the actual event is that there would have been people still alive who would have been there when the crucifixion and his resurrection happened. And if they didn't happen, and they heard this creed was going on, they'd have said, well, wait a minute. I was there. That never happened. But nowhere in Scripture or in any historical writings do we find anyone stepping up to say, wait a minute, that's not how it happened. The second proof is the tomb itself. Mary didn't go to the wrong tomb. All the Jews and the believers, they knew exactly which tomb Jesus was in. And had the body still been in the tomb, people would have gone and gotten it. They would have rolled away the stone and said, "Look, he's right here." But there's no evidence that anyone ever did that. Because they couldn't. Because the body wasn't there. A third proof is if you look at the gospel accounts of the resurrection, you'll find that there's a group of women who are the first to be told or to see that the tomb was empty. Now, ladies, please, I'm just the messenger, okay? At this point in history, women were on the lowest rung of the social ladder. Okay, women, you could not be a witness. If 15 of you saw someone commit a murder, that person was going free because they wouldn't accept you as a witness in the trial. Okay? You weren't highly thought of. And so, for them to be the ones who found the tomb empty had to be true, because in some ways it was embarrassing for the gospel writers to write that. Had it been made up, they'd have changed the women to men. But because it's true, they wrote what actually happened. And what actually happened is that women went to the tomb and they found it empty. And the final proof is the question that everyone was asking. Everyone was asking, what happened to the body? Nobody was claiming that the body was still in the tomb. Everybody was looking for what happened to it and looking for how to cover it up, to cover up the fact that the tomb was empty. No one was going around saying, well, wait a minute, I've got the body right here. Because they couldn't, because the body was gone. It was alive. So what do we need to understand this morning? What do we need to take away on this Easter Sunday about the resurrection of Jesus? There are three things that I want you to take away this morning. The first is, God is God. The resurrection proves that God is who He said He says He is, and that He will do what He says He will do. It shows that He is the giver of life, that He is control of life and death. It shows that He is stronger than death. And what that says to us is that no matter what you are facing today, He is greater. He is stronger. If He can conquer death, He can conquer your family feud. He can help you through the physical crisis. He can lift you up when you're in that valley. Wherever you find yourself, whatever is going on, He is greater. Because He defeated death. And He can defeat whatever you're going through. The second takeaway is that the resurrection gives us life. God shows Himself to be the giver of life, and that we get to be the recipients of it. Romans 6:23 says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord." 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. He has new life. That born again thing. The old has gone, the new has come. John 10:10, one of my favorite verses. Jesus is speaking. He says, I have come that they may have life. And He says, it's not just any life. It's not just a so-so, humdrum, boring, get through the day life. He says, but I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. Have it in abundance. Do you understand that? He's come to give you life, true life, that you might live as He desires you to live. And that life comes through the good news of God's grace. It's the idea that God has this heaven that He wants all of us to have and to experience, not just for an hour or a day or a year, but forever. But that heaven is perfect. Because the Bible says we are sinners, because we have made poor choices, we are not perfect. And the only way to get the free gift that He's given, wants to give to us, is through His Son. No matter how hard you try, no matter what great things you do, you cannot earn it. Hear me? You can't earn it. No matter how hard you pedal that bike, no matter how much you climb up that hill, it is not enough. Because even though you try, even though you work your fingers to the bone, even though you give it everything you've got, you are still in your sin. The only way to receive that life is through the blood of Jesus and the fact that He walked out of that tomb. The third thing to take away from today is that life comes with some expectations. It comes at a cost because that life, as we saw in the skit, needs to be chiseled. I'm the first to admit I'm at the top of the list of those believers who think that I can just live however I want to, that God will just forgive me, that I can go ahead and do this because, well, God's gracious. I take my faith too lightly. But as we saw in the skit, the point of our faith is not salvation. It's not just to be saved. It's not a fire insurance. It's not a get out of jail free card. The point of our faith is so that we can fulfill the vision that God has for us. That we can look like He wants us to look. And He wants us to look like His Son, Jesus. Our worth doesn't come from what we do. Our salvation doesn't come from what we try. It all comes and is all based on what we do with Jesus and the cross and the empty tomb. And to think anything else demeans and disrespects the sacrifice of Christ and diminishes His resurrection. To think that He was on the cross and to say, well, now I've got to earn it, puts His sacrifice in vain. It says, thank you for giving all. Thank you for giving your life, but that wasn't quite good enough. It got the ball rolling. Now I'll pick it up from here, God. Thanks. Really? When we honestly say that, when we honestly think that, when God looks at each of us, He has a vision of what He wants us to look like, of who He wants us to be like, just like the sculptor. But within us, there are a lot of unnecessary parts and evil elements that need to be removed, just like the block of stone. And when we profess faith in Christ, what we're saying is, or what we should be saying is, it's okay to use the hammer and the chisel. It's okay to go ahead and get rid of that sin, to get rid of that ugliness, to remove that obstacle, to get rid of that stumbling block I keep tripping over. Does it hurt? Yeah. Is it painful? You bet. Is it necessary? Well, that depends on what vision you want to fulfill. See, if you want to just look like the world and continue to look like yourself, when you look in that mirror, all you see is yourself, then the chisel and hammer probably aren't going to be tools that you're going to ask to be used on. But if your desire, and it should be your desire if you make that profession of faith, if your desire is to look like Jesus, then yes, the hammer and the chisel are necessary. See, as believers, we tend to minimize the expectations and the implications of our faith. But the resurrection says we don't have that right. How dare we profess a holy, perfect, sacrificial name of Jesus on Sunday and then curse it, demean it, and stomp on it Monday through Saturday? How dare we come in this place, sing praises to His name, and then go out and act like the world, live like we've never heard the name of Jesus. We have too many who claim faith, but are simply playing the game. Their faith hasn't impacted them or changed them in any way, and they mock the name of Jesus by their actions, by their words, and by their lives. The resurrection reminds us that a great sacrifice was paid for each and every one of us. And that through that resurrection, we can have new life. True life. And for this, we should celebrate and rejoice, right? Praise the Lord!
Yes.
But when we do that, when we make that profession of faith, let us do so with understanding and with the seriousness that it deserves. Knowing that with that profession of faith comes a hammer and a chisel. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this resurrection day. We thank you, Lord, for this day in which the tomb was empty, in which life was given to us, because life was given to Jesus. And Lord, we're thankful for his sacrifice. But Lord, we also need forgiveness, Lord, because we take that too lightly. We abuse it. We don't grasp the depth and the importance of what it means to be a follower of you. And it means that we allow you to begin to mold us and to shape us so that we look like Jesus. Help us, Lord, not to be afraid of that, but to embrace that. In his name we pray.
Amen.
As we come to the communion table, we come to symbols of broken body. Bread symbolizes the body of Christ. The cup symbolizes the blood shed for us. We come to this table understanding that it was through this sacrifice that paid our debts. But we also come knowing that these are just symbols. That the body was put back together, if you will, and walked out of the tomb. And in that resurrection, it's given us the opportunity for life, for hope, for forgiveness, for relationship with God our Father. Let's pray for the bread. Father God, thank you for this bread that symbolizes your broken body. Lord, as we partake of it together, remind us of the sacrifice that you made for us. And help us, Lord, to live in such a way that we exalt and honor that, not demean it, not diminish it, not disrespect it. In the name of Jesus, we pray.
Thank you.
Father God, as we stand at the communion table today, Lord, in your presence, we pray that as we drink of the cup, that you would pour it into us your Spirit, the Holy Spirit, to begin to refine us from the inside out as he radically changes who we are in Christ Jesus. In his name I pray. Amen.
Helps us, help others in our community, the needs that they have.